Productions.
Welcome to the Mad Life Podcast, where the chaos of everyday life meets the conquest of everyday dreams. Here is your host, Mad Clock.
What's up, everyone? This is the Mad Life Podcast. This episode is always brought to you by our wonderful sponsors of First Angel Media and Brutal Business Entertainment. This week, I got the homie Morbid Psychosis on the line. What's up, dude?
How you doing this evening?
Good, man. How about yourself?
You know, just chilling, watching cops and shit.
There you go. Enjoying a little R&R. Yep. I imagine just after day of the work week, I'd imagine, right?
Yeah, you gotta put the feet in.
Yep, gotta get that paycheck, man. So, for everyone that doesn't know you, basically introduction, go ahead and introduce yourself to the audience.
I'm known as Sick Geo, Morbid Psychosis, Gorilla Tainment, Brutal Business Entertainment. That's how we roll. Yeah, been doing this thing for a little bit, just started doing it by myself. For a bit, and getting things in order. How y'all doing?
Yeah, bro. All right, so describe your music best you can, I guess.
Started off calling it gangsta metal. My EP doesn't reflect that as much as I would like it to, but it's more because it's the instrumentals that go with it too. There's supposed to be some guitars. I didn't really have too much guitars on the EP.
Right on.
But yeah, you'll hear some guitar work in the newer songs that are being worked on, to where you'll get more of the gangsta metal feel. But it's more of like my roots of dark rap and all that for the EP, Blood, Sweat, and Years. It's more of my roots of like dark rap or with a mix of the metal and the lyrics, but also like to where that would be deemed horrorcore, since I don't really have the guitar work that I would like on there. And
I'm gonna have to throw you some guitar stuff your way, man, see if you can use it.
Oh, definitely. I heard some of your beats. So, yeah, no, I was feeling those.
Right on. For sure. I did a demo live, actually, just kind of showing how I layer everything with the guitar and all that. So, yeah, I'll shoot you something here the next couple of weeks, probably, when I get a minute. Busy life. Speaking of the mad life, that's kind of how I run these episodes. I try to find the guys that are, you know, grinding outside the music sense every day. You know, we got a lot to deal with, families, kids, jobs, all these other things outside of our everyday life. So you got children, yeah?
Yeah. Yep. Definitely. Got three beautiful psychotic children.
Yeah, right on. How has that experience kind of influenced your music?
It's heartwarming because at times you'll see them doing something musically, or my oldest, he's been to a lot of concerts, just different moments with that. It was a little heartwarming. He had got on stage when he was younger with Project Born.
And then, watching them enjoy themselves is like mind blowing, man.
Yeah.
Yeah. I totally relate. I took my oldest boy, Xavier, to the Millvale Metal Festival. And he got to watch Randy and Feast of the Fallen and all them boys. And he was just like captivated immediately, you know. Randy hooked him up with his shirt. He got stickers. Like, he's on this like sticker collection gip now. Because I was telling one of the next shows, actually, well, I have a couple coming up. But we have one together with opening for Razakel late September. He wants to go to that one too, because I played her music and Ritual of Ether and all that. And he's like, "Oh, you're opening for the, I gotta get stickers." That was like his big thing. He had to go. Yeah. Yeah. He's like, I gotta get stickers, Dad. Like that, dude. But yeah.
Yeah, that's a great way to keep memories. Stickers. I got a couple stickers for him.
Yeah, well, we've been grabbing them up too, and then we've been lining our merchandise bin with everything, all the stickers we get from the shows and shit. So
yeah, that's
we're getting. Up. We want to get the whole front of it covered. So, you know, one of the deep ass fucking totes with the big long lid and all that shit. Yeah. So we want to cover the whole front of it. We're like, all right, we're not moving off the front until the whole front's covered in band stickers, and then we'll just go around the sides. It's like I wanted to like randomly do it. Terry was like, no, like just we're gonna cover one side at a time. But yeah, kids, man, they experience. Have any of them kind of like tried to take on what you're doing at all, or just, you know?
Well, the other day, my youngest, he in the car, he sings a lot, but I wear my sunglasses that mic came on, and that's his joint right there. That's one of his joints.
Nice.
That and Tom Petty's "Don't Do Me Like That." He sits there singing it and dancing to him.
Hell yeah! And that's, you know, a lot of people have this stigma, I guess I call it that, of like, you know, rappers only listen to hip hop. We're not well educated outside that genre. Like, we just don't know music in general. You know, especially you having kind of a metal style in your hip hop as well as I do. You know that it takes. Yeah. We've listened for classic rock. I even listened to like orchestra shit, dude. Bach and Beethoven are dope. Like, absolutely, dude. Fucking, it's like you have all those other influences and listen to all them sounds, and just the sound of good music inspires you. You know what I mean?
Yeah, and like that's why I like watching some shit about music, because then you get a little deeper in depth about things. Like, right. I've been rewatching season one of the Wu-Tang Saga.
Right on.
Because season two's coming soon, so I want to be able to see that. And just seeing some of what, like, RZA was picking for certain things, and then just hearing different shit in the music. After seeing that, it's like, I can actually hear why he picked that shit. And it's like some old shit that you heard before, and you're like, how did I not know that was there?
Yeah.
But yeah, he was doing some things with some samples, but like then you think about like the DJs back in the day and how they ended up becoming like the producers because they was the ones picking out the samples anyway.
Yep.
But like, yeah, nah, if you don't have an ear for more than what you listen to, like if you just listen to rap, you're not gonna really experience music the way you should. Right. Like if you only listen to metal, like you're neglecting your brain from this drug.
Absolutely. That's out there. You're limiting yourself at least.
Like, I don't want to say it like that, but that's what it is. Like, music is
it really a drug. Is though. Oh yeah.
Music's a drug, and like, but it's like it's a drug that can help you convey your feelings and emotions,
right?
Rather than destroying them.
Right. It's constructive at the end of the day. Absolutely. You know, you and I both have lyrics that kind of really touch on some shit. You know what I mean?
And then music is also life imitating art. So like, yeah, like, you're neglecting yourself from different aspects of life that you might not even know that you actually felt.
Right. One I used to watch a lot was the Lamb of God, the Killadelphia DVD documentary. I'm a huge Lamb of God fan. The Killadelphia one was a wild DVD, man. It was wild.
I watched that in the early days of recording.
Yeah, I mean, that came out probably like 2004, 5.
Yeah. Trying to get my own shit to record at the time, to where I have my own shit now, but I have nowhere to hook it up.
The constant struggles of a musician, man.
Like, I had it for a minute, and then like I moved a couple different times to where each time it like the space got sucked up.
Right.
But I still have it to where whenever my kids go to want to, if they do want to, it's right fucking there.
Yeah, man.
Pass even though it'll be like, it'll be archaic by then, it'll still be useful because MP3s will last forever.
Oh, yeah. Well, it's like this thing. My kids are starting to play with this. I got a little MPK Mini. It's what I make most of my beats on. And the kids just kind of watch me fuck with it, right? And they just come over and they're like, can I try? I was like, yeah, fuck, grab this thing here. This does this. Check this out. Like, let's see what the little, you know, pea brain can come up with, because they just perceive everything differently. You know what I mean? Kids don't look at things or perceive anything. They just go on instinct and what they feel in the moment. You know, that's so raw.
And I like the fact that, speaking of kids, they whenever they have their little, you know, their little toy keyboards, they actually have microphones hooked up to them, or that you can hook up to them now, to where I didn't even think about that aspect. They've been messing around with that every here and then. But the microphone's cheap, to where, you know, but if they put a little bit better of a microphone on there, some of these kids will do some things real quick.
Yeah, man. Give them that opportunity, you know what I mean? Let them go with it, because it could be something amazing.
My two youngest, they do be singing sometimes, like, and I'll sit there and listen to them, because sometimes I might not be in the same room or something like that. I gotta listen, and I can't surprise them.
Oh, yeah.
But it does bring a different aspect, because then, like, say, whenever they were born and or whatever, and they shit in their diaper, excuse my French. Oh, I would make up songs, and the one it was I did for my youngest, that one I just took Smooth Criminal and changed the words up.
Word.
To where it was leading into the chorus instead of Annie, Is You Okay? I said Buggy Dookie.
That's great, bro. That's great.
To where, like, I sang out the rest. I'm not gonna finish it. But sang out the rest of it, and then, like, he giggled and shit. Yeah. It made it a fun time out of the stinky moment.
Yes. Do you remember they actually won, I think they won an Oscar or whatever. It wasn't for acting, whatever the fucking thing they call it. The big award for Song of the Year, the band Gautier, the French dude. It was somebody that I used to know. Pop song. Yeah. My oldest is in love with that song, and I just hear him just singing it every once in a while. I got it, like, I was upstairs and I heard him doing it, and I'm like, oh, I gotta get this. So I pulled up my phone and I just videotaped and I just heard the whole thing. Oh my god, it's so funny. But God, I don't even know how you pronounce that. Gautier, whatever it was. It was a killer song. It was a killer song, though. Like, everyone knew that. It's still a banger.
I'd be hoping someone else says some band's name sometimes, because I don't want to say it wrong.
Right, yeah. It's like, I openly, like, I don't fucking know how to pronounce it. They were French, I think.
Yeah. I don't know. Well, there's, like, my daughter, she ended up doing, like, her own little rap, and my girl, she recorded it so I could hear. But she did it because she had to do something for school.
Yeah.
And it was like that, so where she had to do rhyming words, so she wrote a little rap or whatever. And then, so I think I seen that, but then there was, like, it was like maybe a month later or something. We were they were chilling, waiting for me to get off of work, and they did that real quick, and it was a whole different rap. And it was like, okay,
wicked. Yeah, put a little smile on your face, like, damn, hell yeah, yep.
I kind of get that some of my music stuff from my dad too. So,
right on.
I give my mom some credit, but she's like, oh, well, I can't sing. But I used to hear her sing songs while she was cleaning and stuff. And I thought it sounded nice. It sounded better than the actual singer sometimes.
Yeah.
But yeah, my dad, like, he was all about music, and he came to the show we did out in Ohio a couple years. Well, right before COVID hit, it was October before COVID hit, I think.
A demo played, Crazies played, and he was at the bar, right? Yeah.
And he came out there with me for that. That was the first show he seen me do.
I'll bet.
And, so, and he loved the entire show. Like he's in the all kinds of music too, to where I got, that's where I got that from. Cause like
right.
I found out in like middle school that he was into like Def Leppard and Body Count. I found an old Body Count shirt.
Oh,
like,
right on, dude.
I got in trouble, I think, for it because it had bullets going through a skull and all that. And then I think it was for the cop killer.
Yeah, yeah.
like, I'm mad I don't have that no more because I was just too young to know that it got banned at the time.
Right, right.
Even before that, because that came out before I was in middle school. But yep. Yeah.
Yep. That's funny as shit. My dad was the same way. He was just into every kind of music, just about. He wasn't big on rap, I guess. I don't know really. I guess ICP kind of started that whole rap thing for me when I was like, you know, 11, 12, turning that adolescent angst, you know, I'm a badass kind of a thing we all go through as little cockful fucking young dudes, you know.
Yeah.
But ICP was pretty much, I mean, besides, like, I listened to, like, Weird Al Yankovic and, like, Coolio back in the day, bro, when I was super young, 6, 7 years old. Coolio was my dude. I have a
story about both of them.
Oh, word.
Yeah. I don't know if I did this in any other interview, but I was mad at Weird Al because I had did my own version of Gangster's Paradise. And
really? Well,
me and a friend did, and he's actually still out there rapping today. We both had collaborated together, and because there's something wrong with me, but but there's something wrong with him too.
Yeah.
And we were like 8, 9, something like that.
Yeah.
When that came out, and we went something like this. We helped each other with words. Because he started it off, and I just started adding words in some places where he started losing it. And then, like, he went off into some crazy shit after that. So that's why I only remember the beginning part.
Yeah. Yeah.
As I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, hold on. As I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I take a dump in the toilet, realize there's nothing left, because I've been passing gas for so long that even my mama thinks I got a butt problem, and I ain't never crossed a turd that didn't deserve it. He be treated like some shit and tossed back in the toilet.
Bro, that's funny as shit. Yeah, like, we ever...
He went off on that after that, like...
Yeah. You ever seriously considered trying to do some like mock up funny ass shit like that?
I actually have an awesome one. It's for some Usher shit. I'm not going to disclose the rest.
Right on.
Or something.
Right on. Yeah. If we get removed. Oh, that's funny as shit, bro. One question I wanted to ask. Any of your kids seen you perform live?
My oldest.
But how'd they enjoy it and all that? I think it was pretty cool.
Yeah, he's been to, I can't even count how many shows.
Oh, yeah.
Since he was at least 5.
Yep, he's been in it.
Yeah.
Hell yeah. The first show I took my oldest son to, it was called Sunday, me and my buddy Matt. He is actually back from training for the service. He and I used to put on shows here in the area. One of them was called Sunday Couch Slaughter. We had a couch donated to us for free, obviously donation, and we put it in the middle of the crowd, and they got to like demolish it and mosh pit and destroy this couch, right? There was pieces of it everywhere by the end of the night. It was just this destructed, mangled piece of wood and fabric. But at one point, my kid was down there moshing, having fun, jumping on it, having a good old time. Whole group of kids decided to grab it, pick it up. They threw it up in the air. Well, it landed on him before it was like totally broke. It was like a whole couch, you know. Kid takes this massive hit from this freaking couch flying out of nowhere, and I didn't even notice him on stage performing at this point. So I didn't know what was going on. I'm doing my thing. My set gets over. Some girl comes over. He's like holding his face and shit. And I'm like, oh my God, like he's never gonna want to come back here again. Like this, you know. It was his first show. I think it was going to ruin it for him. Like he took a lump pretty good. We got back and I was like, so how you feeling? He's like, I want to go back. He instantly was like, that was so cool. And I'm like, you know, a whole ass couch dropped on you, bro. And he's still like, let's go. So yeah, I just he's always been and his first like major con, like I said, was that Millvale thing. And just he got to see like 6-7 different bands in a whole day and experience the busy streets and the commotion and the all the vendors, like the full kind of being in it, man. His he was just like everywhere he went, he was just wide-eyed, being like, "This is so cool." So I'm really interested to see where he goes in the future with the interest that I kind of see in him now. It's funny, all the kids have like this band. My four oldest, they call it the Seasons. They've realized they're all born in one of the four seasons, the four oldest kids.
Yeah.
So they call it the fucking Seasons. And as you know, my wife, Tara, does all my merchandise and stuff and whatnot. And they were just like, well, Dad, can you make us a logo? Like, can we get a logo and shit made? And then, can we get t-shirts? And I'm like, y'all don't even know how to fucking play. Yeah. Like, in it, you know what I mean? Like, they're so excited about it. It's like, let them fucking have the thing. So we got a logo design made, and we getting them little youth side shirts, and they're gonna rock their own band shirts, bro. Like they just think they're the shit. It's really cool, but they are learning. Like my one kid's really interested in the guitar, and like you know the pad I got here, and they just see me doing it all the time. Dad, what are you doing? Where are you going this weekend? Some of the shows I can't take them to, but for the you know the all ages ones, I try to take the older kids. So
yeah,
I figure shit if my career doesn't go anywhere. My kids would be famous and I can manage them.
Exactly. That was like, I should have retired by now, but as an artist, you never retire just because it's not something it's a passion you have. It's something you love. Right. So you don't quit it. You never quit it. Even if you do retire, you're still doing things.
Right. You know, I mean, it's not like boxing gloves. You know what I mean? You can hang those up because you just body can't. But, you know, music is ageless in a sense. So Look at Ozzy. Look at Bob Dylan. Look at them dudes. They're not fucking stopping. I mean.
Dude from the Rolling Stones that just died was, what, drummer. 80? 80?
80, yeah. Yep.
Yeah.
Exactly. And they were still touring regularly up until that point. Exactly. Like, they've been going.
Exactly.
AC/DC, Def Leppard. Not that I'm a huge Def Leppard fan, but
it's a love that you have. Like,
right.
Whether it be an instrument, vocally, all instruments, like, it's a love that you have. Like, yeah.
So, I mean, not calling you an old man, but you've been around... You know, you've been on Brutal for even how long now?
I think what, 2.5, almost 3 years, something like that. Right it on. Might have just hit 3 years.
Right on.
Yeah, I think it just hit 3 years.
Well, you've been doing music, obviously, for quite a long time.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You have some trials and tribulations. There's always a road that a person takes, and whether it be the right path or not, it's a path that you have to go through, and because it's life, that's your life path, and you go through it. And whenever you're doing music, sometimes you hit, sometimes you miss. You actually have a short window to actually create something that's gonna make shit last, and I'm trying to tell my kid. My oldest, so because he's in high school, and that's when that window opens up. Because then, just because you're doing music, if people don't know you or like you, that's a way for them to know you,
right? Or
be like, oh, well, he's doing something constructive, I kind of like him now, right? Because like, they didn't know you to like you,
right?
But they just wanted to hate, to where now they're like, oh. Well, that's kind of cool. I'm like, what's up? What you did?
Yeah, dude. Creation itself is a language. You know what I mean? You're creating. Mm-hmm. You're doing something positive. You're doing something outside the, you know, what everyone else can or does. Even though you know everyone raps nowadays, but regardless,
I want him to know that like you can do it. Just while you're under 18, don't cuss. Just do. You can do whatever you want. You want to do songs about masturbation? Do that.
Yep.
You want to
right?
You want to just don't cuss. Like do anything. You want to do songs about how a butterfly turns into a butterfly from a caterpillar,
right?
In a weird ass way. Do it. Do that shit. So yep. People need to hear that.
Yep.
They might not want to hear it at first, but they need to hear that just because it's going to imprint on them, whether it be positively or negatively, but they're going to need some type of imprint from you for you to make a mark.
And music is very person. It's very perspective driven. You know what I mean? It's very from perspective. So, I mean, you could be talking about, you know, a caterpillar turning into a beautiful butterfly, but the next person that hears that song could be like, oh, wow, that was a song about somebody, you know, growing up and finding themselves and discovering, you know what I mean? It's perspective. So that's, you can write something relatable. It doesn't matter what the story is or started out as. Other people will latch on. They'll get it. You know what I mean?
And I've listened to a lot of weird music to where, like, I found some music that was like, yeah, I don't feel like listening to this shit. And then there was some music that was, like, weird that I know nobody else is really going to like it. I'm like, yeah, this is dope. But, like, how you were saying, like, your dad wasn't too big on rap or whatever.
Right.
I meet people all the time and I'll be like, what kind of music are you into? And they'll be like, oh, I like anything but country. And I'm like, why not? Why not though? Because there's country out there that's dope as fuck. Like,
absolutely. I'm more into like the old style country and shit. The new stuff's kind of like, but it's innovative enough that they've been making it their own thing.
I like bluegrass.
Yes. Folk.
Folk, yep. I love folk
music, dude. You some of them fucking folk punk bands are like gnarly as shit, dude.
That and folk rap.
Yes.
There's a polka metal band.
No shit. I had to check that out.
The only band I heard of so far of it was Korpik Lani. I might have to text the spelling of that if I can remember it, but
yeah,
I should have it on the YouTube queue.
I mean, I listen, like Mongolian throat music. This shit's incredible. Like, how do you do that? You know what I mean? That's like my end of the weird spectrum.
I want to do a little more weird shit.
Yeah.
But I have to figure out how to do it. There's a couple that I do have queued up there.
Yep. Give it a whack at it, right?
Yeah. I mean, I also try to just like change my voice around a little bit so it doesn't sound like the exact same song all the time and shit.
Right. Yeah, getting different feels for songs. But some people that don't do music probably wouldn't even understand that is very difficult to do. You can write a song, you can write a decent song, but to write a decent song and to make it sound unique from the last is kind of a talent in itself, you know.
I do some crazy deep voice shit, like, but it's like throat deep voice. Like, I used to, whenever Scream came out and the whole hang up on me, I'll get you like a fish, I used to make that, but like, I found that there's like an octave there and I wanted to do it on a couple of recordings, but it's rough. Plus, I smoke cigarettes. I did it live a few times, and it sounds crazy. I did it on Fuck Up Off Me, but the engineer, he had tweaked it a little bit to where it doesn't really sound exactly like how I do it. But,
That's actually one of my favorite songs by you is Fuck Up Off Me. I love that. That's a jam, dude.
Well, the deep voice back off me part toward the end.
Yeah.
I'm doing that actually. He just tweaked it and like I'm yeah, you sucked for that. But it didn't turn out bad. So he didn't really suck for that.
Yep.
He did hook that track up. But what do you do for work?
Me?
Mm-hmm.
Kind of freelance at the moment. I used to work at a beer distributor.
Oh, that's where.
Yep.
That's what's up. You? Me? I'm a manager or something. A supervisor or manager of a warehouse. that does auctions online.
That's wicked. How is that?
I mean, I've been there for almost a year. It's pretty cool. There's some ups and downs sometimes.
Yeah, most jobs.
I was being nice to a guy as much as I could without, like, changing tones in my voice. And, like, he asked if he could speak to someone above me. And I said, sure, and directed him where he could go. And I got called an angry black guy.
Nice.
He turned out to be a cop, but hey.
Shit happens, man.
I wasn't trying to be a dick or anything. I was just trying to get by what I can go by. I mean,
yep.
You can talk to my superior.
Sometimes people need to be told, man. No doubt.
What's the male version of a Karen? Is that a Mitch?
A Ken.
A Ken? Okay.
Ken. Yeah. My wife came up with that one day, and it was funny as shit. She's Ken. I'm like, what the fuck is that? She goes, male version of a Karen. Bitches all the time. Man's on his fucking period. I was like, oh, dude, I was dying. I was losing my shit.
Together, man, there's a K and an E and an N in both.
Yes. Yeah, the only thing you're missing is the A and the R. Yeah.
Broken down like a science.
Right? Are you into, like, video games, you know, anime and all that kind of shit, too?
I'm into anime. Video games, I don't really play them as much as I used to. Like, I'm an 80s baby, 90s kid. I definitely seen technology change. My system that I have is a PS3.
Right on. I have one, too. You can't really beat it, dude. That's some of the funnest games on any platform. For, like, after PlayStation 1, yeah, all that kind of, you know, PS2 was great. You know, a lot of good time. But PS3 had some, like, killer games on it, man.
I got a little arcade panel. It has, like, almost 4,000 games on it.
Oh, yeah. Raspberry Pi?
I don't no, it's not Raspberry Pi. I gotta look at the name again, but I can't see it from here. I need my glasses.
Yeah, a little preloaded little gearbox.
But yeah, it has me and my daughter beat Michael Jackson's Moonwalk together, and then it has the OG Madden on it, the very first Madden.
Dog, was that 99?
Nah, it was like, I want to say like 96, 97.
Right on.
But they don't really give it credit like that. But yeah, right, it's old. Because it was like right after Joe Montana's little game that he had.
Oh, bet. Okay. And I don't know if I played the OG Madden. I always thought 99 was the first one. That was when I grew up playing. So, I mean.
Yeah, it was. Well, that's the one that they'd be giving the credit to. That's okay. The one with that it took off with. Because Tecmo Bowl was still big at the time. Like, the ones without Bo Jackson.
Yeah.
They were still big at the time to where, like, the first Madden had came out around whenever the, like, one of the last couple Tecmo Bowls came out. And, yeah, I guess after that, a couple years later was the 99 one, and because they had the EA dips, and those ones weren't that good, and then EA and Madden linked up, and it was like, yeah, this is on point.
Yep, they basically started a franchise. I mean, it was probably the biggest fucking sports game on the video game market, easily.
Hell yeah. Nah, whenever I was younger, I definitely was on video games hardcore.
Yeah.
Like, I had magazines and shit. Like, I used to, like, I waited for Earthworm Jim to come out.
Bro, fuck yes. Now we're talking. I was born in 88, so I started playing, like, early Nintendo 1. like 92, 93, 4 years old, five, somewhere around there.
Yeah, I got Mike Tyson's punch out on this thing too.
Dude, me and my dad played that for so fucking long. I love punch out.
I gotta get used to playing it again because I got like to the third person and got my ass whooped. I was like,
it takes a minute. Yeah.
I was like, I used to get way further than this.
Well, we're probably so used to these like smooth fucking games now, and them just doing the thing is smooth. Yeah. You know what I mean? Like, it's all kind of rough, like
for real
punching shit now, so it's weird.
I thought I would have got beat sooner because whenever I first played Mario back around whenever again. Back whenever I was like 21, 22, it was hard to get past like the first 30 seconds of the first board. I was like, what the fuck's going on, man?
right.
But yeah, PS3 definitely has some games that's like,
Dude, my favorite, okay, top two of my, off top of my head I can think of for PlayStation 3 would be DMC.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, that's probably my favorite one besides Devil May Cry 2. And Prototype 2.
All right. So, yeah. PS3. Damn. I like Crimson Land. That was probably a little later in PS3, but that was nice. And Condemned 2. Condemned 2.
Okay, right on.
I like that because you could go do the fight clubs, beat people with hammers and stuff.
Yeah, bro.
But the story mode, like that was pretty different too. Like, because I was like, whoa, let me grab this brick and throw it at a crackhead real quick so I can get past this. Like, it was some crazy shit I wasn't ready for at the time. But there's, I like I can't just stop there. I like that one Mortal Kombat. With who's on that one? Was it Batman? Mortal Kombat versus DC. Yeah, that one.
Yes, that one's dope. That's a gem. That one's a gem. Yeah, all PS3s are fucking great, man. I love that. Really, really good console.
That Arkham Asylum.
Yes. I had Arkham Stories, actually. I just finished a little bit ago.
Okay.
Had that on Xbox One. I prefer PlayStation, but my brother-in-law got a trayless one and had just bought an Xbox One, but the trayless one came out, and he was like, oh, I got to have it. And the kids, he let the kids play on the one with the tray for the longest time, and then he moved out. He's like, just keep it. And I was like, it's like the newest gaming system I have because I have a PS3. I got a PS2. I got a regular Xbox 360. I want to get an N64. That's the next one I want to get. And then I got to get a Super Nintendo too. I wasn't really big into Sega. I mean, I like Sega for like Beavis and Butthead and Sonic.
Yeah.
That was the coolest game ever, dude.
I heard that they were coming out with Do America 2.
Yeah, dude. I did hear that. That's going to be cool. That's going to be badass.
Yeah. My son has I forget what it's called, but it's like this big, and then it has a cartridge area where you can put Sega games, but it has built-in Sega games on it.
Sick.
Yeah, which that arcade thing got like the first Tekken on it.
Oh yeah, that one's dope.
But it sucks on there.
I played the first Tekken on, actually, it's funny you mentioned that. I played it on PlayStation 1 when it came out. And, I remember the bear being so blocky. King? Yeah. King? No, King was the fucking cat. What the hell was the bear's name? I forget.
It's bear in Japanese.
Okay, I can't remember. But anyway, I remember him looking so blocky. It looked like a bunch of blocks piled together on the screen, bro. It was terrible. It was great, though.
Was it Kikomon or was it something on?
It was something on, I think. Yeah. I can't remember. Tomb Raider was fucking great on PlayStation 1, too. The original Tomb Raider, that was fun as fuck.
Yeah. Shit, Crash Bandicoot used to be dope.
Yes, Crash, Ratchet and Clank.
Gex.
Those were all fun. Gex, that was fucking awesome as shit.
Worms. I got Worms. I got Worms and for PS3. It's all the
bro. Do you remember Oddworld?
Yeah, Oddworld was dope.
Oddworld was fun as hell.
Fuck. I still get down with cartoons though.
Oh, absolutely.
I want to find more DVDs of old shit because like I have some old shit like what's it like Beavis and Butthead. The only thing that sucks about the Beavis and Butthead on DVD is they don't play it out like it was on TV.
Okay. Like,
that's just some bullshit. And you have to get a certain edition that has the music videos that they showed that you have to watch separately.
That's dumb.
But I'm trying to find like MTV's oddities, like the head and all that. They seen a couple episodes of some of them, but it was on YouTube, so you don't really get the full episode all the time.
I was a big fan of Daria. That was a good one.
Yeah, my daughter knows who that is because my girl has that shirt, and then like there's like there'll be like people in the store or whatever like, oh, I like your shirt, what's it from? You're like our age, like what's wrong with you? MTV motherfucker, like nah, I was kind of a couch potato around them times for a second.
Yeah,
but I was for some reason I was always outside, but I was always watching TV, listening to music, or watching cartoons or some type of comedy.
Hell yeah!
But yeah, no, they seen the old school He-Man. They rebooted He-Man, like Masters of the Universe. Okay. They rebooted it into an anime.
No shit.
Yeah, on Netflix.
Is it good?
I didn't watch it yet, but I seen the previews. It looks pretty dope.
Okay, right on. I wasn't a huge He-Man fan, but I mean, I'm definitely willing to check it out.
I get to watch stuff like that more on the weekends because I'm too busy during the week.
Right on.
But they seen Toxic Avenger.
Nice.
Well, the Toxic Crusader is the cartoon.
Okay.
So they seen that.
Yeah.
And yeah, they like that. They love Beetlejuice.
Oh yeah. Yeah, my kids are on the old school shit. Actually, it's funny. My oldest daughter, Alicia's favorite cartoon when she was growing up was Tom and Jerry.
Yeah.
And it was just really cool that she latched onto something that I liked as a kid a lot. You know, it's like Coyote, Roadrunner, that kind of shit, you know. But she really loved Tom and Jerry. And then I made a joke the one day we were watching, I don't know what the fuck we were watching, but we watch, you know, Simpsons every once in a while on like Hulu or something just for something to watch, you know? And I guess she had never caught an itchy and scratchy episode. So we were to like talk bullshit. And I mentioned the name and she goes, what's that? And I was like, what's what? She was like, what's itchy and scratchy? And I was like, are you shitting me? You're almost 13. I failed as a father if I haven't showed you itchy and scratchy. So I showed her. She was like, that is the coolest thing in the world. So she went on YouTube and you can find full compilations of every episode in one block of video back to back.
That's dope.
It's super cool. So we sat there, dude, we died laughing, just for an hour died laughing watching all the itchy and scratchies back to back. It was great.
Put your kids on Trap Three Little Pigs.
Okay, never heard of that.
Just do it.
Right on.
Because I put mine on like Green Jellos.
Right on.
Yeah, and so we went through looking for Three Little Pig songs, and I forgot about that, and we stumbled upon it, and put your kids on that.
Bet, I bet. My kids also like. I kind of by default, I'm a huge Rick and Morty fan.
Okay.
You know. I think I had to let the two older ones get to a certain age before they started like watching it. You know, if they like passed by in the room and I had it on, like, oh, fuck, whatever, you ain't gonna pay attention. But they got older, and the newer, well, season 4 was like kind of Yeah. That one was pretty racy. Like, you know, it's fucking foul to begin with, but it's not like Big Mouth foul. You know what I mean? Yeah. Big Mouth's talking about like fucking nuns and you know, all this other like crazy shit, you know. And so like, I had to like screen season 4 for Rick and Morty because I like make sure it's nothing that's like too out of inappropriate for them to watch. But I mean, the general context of Rick and Morty is pretty foul as it is. So it's like, you know, where's the line? But there's a lot of like incestual innuendos in season 4, and I was like, we're getting pretty old. Let's not travel down that road just yet. That's okay. We can live a life without knowing about that real quick. Yeah. You know what I mean? So I was like, yeah, Dad, let me watch for a new season. I was like, well, give me a couple more years. I'm just going to give you a couple more years. You need to experience other shit first before hearing that.
Going the insatiable.
Yeah, man.
You ever see that? Yeah, that Gollum the Insatiable with the little girl and Gollum the
That's bad.
Yeah, they be cutting up.
Oh yeah, Big Mouth is bad though. Big Mouth is real bad.
Yeah, F is for Family.
Yeah, I saw a couple episodes and I was like, how the fuck does this shit make TV, man? Like, that's wow,
funny as hell. That's.
It is funny as fuck, but it's like, damn. I mean, we thought like Family Guy was racy back in the day. That shit just plows right over that in terms of lewdness.
You know who does that?
Is that Seth Farland?
Bill Burr.
Okay, that dude is hilarious.
Yeah, that's him doing the dad's voice.
He voices the, yeah, okay, I fucking knew I recognized that shit, dude, yeah.
He's supposed to be the little redhead boy.
That's great. Oh, my God. That's one of the biggest fucking comebacks in comedy history, to play that and then have that be you. Like,
yeah.
That's great. That's fucking great. He
believes he's seen things, so. But, yeah, concerts. I'm hoping that they chill out and everything chills out. Because, like, yeah, a year and a half for me to be able to do a concert, like, that is rough.
Yeah, that's bad. I'm very grateful for the plethora of events I've been able to play so far. And then the handful I still have left to do. Like, I got lucky. But anyway, I swear to God, I was telling the team earlier, like, if Twisted gets shut down, you're going to be dragging me out of the basement at Christmas from depression.
Yeah.
Bro, that's no bueno. I'm not going to be okay if I miss that.
And then, yeah, if Razakel at the Subalpine on September 27th gets canceled, I'll be mad as shit.
Lose my fucking mind, dude.
Because, yeah, that'd be whack. Because, like, there's so many of us that were actually able to go do shows. And it's like, We're all getting closer, and it's like, yeah.
Yeah, fucking crazy. Just open for Ed P. Like, they're on the bill for Razakel as well with us.
Yeah. And Twisted with you, yeah.
Yep. Like, we got to get these shows in, man, because it might, who knows? But I really hope it don't fucking happen until these shows. I'll lose my damn mind. I'll lose my fucking mind. Dude, I've been listening to Twisted since I was like fucking 12, bro. Yeah.
Yeah. Last time me and Crazies had a show that got canceled at the like in March. Yeah. Yep. And I think they had one set up after March, and it was like, yeah, they had two that got canceled. That was wild.
Yep.
But yeah, speaking of the Crazies, you had mentioned a memory for your son going to concerts. One of my son, my oldest, his favorite rappers is Ritz.
And hell yeah, dude.
Me and the Crazies had opened up for Ritz, and he went with us, and he liked that shit. He was loving it. And then at the end, bro, Ritz came down in the crowd, and like that blew his whole mind. Like, so he met Ritz, but right before that, he had met Tech, because I had the little VIP being on the street team.
Yeah,
I took him with me. Because he was helping me do the street team stuff.
Yep.
Yeah, I took him with me, and he met Tech, and he was geeked about that. Like,
I bet, dude. That's wicked. So you got to meet Ritz too and shit.
Mm-hmm. And Tech and Ritz were two of his favorite rappers. So,
oh yeah. You ever done anything with Yellow Wolf?
Nah, I wish.
Yeah, dude, that's one dude. That dude's in my line of sight here soon. Yeah. Yeah, fucking, he doing this American thing, and then, well, Ritz pretty much got his, like, bigger steps start with Yellow, and then yeah. Ritz went to Strange.
But yeah, like, with that American, yeah.
Yellow Wolf's a fucking man.
Yellow Wolf got a show on Crackle.
Where he takes, like, the backwoods shit.
Yeah.
Yeah, bro, I love watching that shit.
That's just dope. I've seen that and I was like, yeah, that's dope as fuck.
Fucking taking people out of the middle of nowhere and like, let's do some yeehaw shit.
But yeah, speaking of the jobs and shit earlier, you're from the Erie area, right? That's where you're at?
Yeah. Edinburgh is like 20 minutes outside of Erie, but yeah, pretty much I've been operated in Erie for a while.
Yeah. My job might be possibly thinking about invading that area because they've been invading Western Pennsylvania. But so far they got a spot in Beaver, McKees Rocks,
yep.
Butler, and Washington, PA. And it's called Mac Discount. Like, yeah. So if anybody want to check that out.
Yeah, man.
It's a... make sure you inspect it. It's resale. Yeah.
Good shit.
Oh, yeah. I gotta try to get some more money. Out of my bosses. They got more people buying stuff.
Right.
I've raced through the ranks there pretty fast. Like,
that's good.
I've worked in like three different departments since I've been there, and it's been under a year, and I'm already helping run the company.
Good shit.
Hell yeah.
Good deal. Well, we're approaching up to the hour mark here. I usually cut these about here. Yeah, I like wrapping these up with like a, you know, I mean, especially you've been doing this music thing for quite some time, and I respect your experience, and it's something people should really pay attention to, that's trying to get into this music business while keeping in mind having to balance all these other aspects of our lives. You know what I mean? What's one piece of advice you give somebody that's really trying to get somewhere with this?
One piece of advice that's really trying to get somewhere with it. I want it to be good advice, good sound advice.
Something that's never failed you thinking about time and time again.
Make sure that it's your fault that things didn't happen.
I like that. Absolutely. I like that. You know, you got to take responsibility for it, man. If it didn't work out, what did you do wrong?
Because things will happen if you're doing it.
Right. Keep yourself in check. Keep yourself motivated constantly. This is on me. I got to make this happen. This is what I got to do.
Mm-hmm.
Very, very, keep yourself very self-driven for sure. It will do that. Keep you honest too. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. You can't be like, oh, well, I didn't show up because like, no, nah, what the fuck did you do? You didn't show up. Yeah. Hold yourself accountable. I like that.
Very nice. Show up. Yeah.
Absolutely. Absolutely, bro. You want to be there, you'll be there.
Yeah. If you really want it, you'll find a way, yeah.
Absolutely.
Make sure it's you that it's the reason it didn't happen.
Yes, sir. I like that. You heard it here first, everybody. Morbid Psychosis from Brutal Business Entertainment, a wonderful label mate. I cannot wait to fucking play with you, Razakel, at the Sub Alpine, September 27th. Let's go. Let's do
all
it.
All day, every day. And y'all peep day, that. Morbid Psychosis EP, Blood, Sweat, and Years. You can find it on Bandcamp, Spotify, you know, YouTube. It's on everywhere but iTunes.
And the shameless social media throwouts. Go for it.
You can find me on Facebook, Morbid Psychosis, just like it's spelled here. Pretty much any social site that's out there that you use, or streaming platform that you use, you can find it under that name. YouTube is Morbid Sick TV. Yay, yay.
Yeah, boy. All right, thank you for enjoying this episode of the Mad Life Podcast. Again, brought to you by wonderful sponsors, First Danger Media and Brutal Business Entertainment. Stay real. Get it done. Catch y'all later.